Hello everyone and welcome back. This is Dr. O. In this video, we're going to talk through the temporal and infratemporal fossae. So specifically, what are the bony structures and landmarks that will delineate these fossa? And we'll talk about what is contained within them. So the temporal fossa tends to be a little bit more straightforward to kind of imagine the space that it occupies. And one of the first things you want to think about is back to those superior and inferior temporal lines. And those are the attachment points we saw from temporalis and the temporalis fascia. Those are running up and along here, and that's the superior-most aspect of the temporal fossa. Now, inferiorly, we can see that it ends at the zygomatic arch laterally, and then at that infratemporal crest here in white medially. Now, within it, we see the temporalis muscle and its fascia, then its blood supplies and nerves. So we see the deep temporal arteries, veins, and nerves. Also, the superficial temporal artery will pass up and around. Well, remember, the superficial temporal artery is one of the terminal branches of the external carotid artery and will come up to occupy and supply this space up here. Also, the zygomaticotemporal nerve, which we'll talk about in future sessions, will be within this space. Now, the medial most aspect of the temporal fossa is made up of a point on the skull called the terion. The terion is where the frontal, parietal, temporal, and sphenoid bones meet. And at this point, we also see that there are actually middle meningeal artery branches just deep to this point. So this is a point where an injury can take place, leading to an epidural hematoma, in the case of if that middle meningeal artery is disturbed, but it is an important point on the lateral side of the skull. Then, if we're thinking about most lateral, so toward us, toward away from the slide, toward the viewer, that is the temporal fascia. So the temporal fascia is that is running around superficial to that temporalis muscle. So let's take a look at what that looks like in somewhat of a 3D. These are just going to be annotations, so they're not perfect, but I hope that this kind of gives you a feel for the space. So from those superior and inferior temporal lines down to the zygomatic arch and that infratemporal crest. So that space containing temporalis muscle, its blood supply, and other neurovasculature is the temporal fossa. Now, the infratemporal fossa is a little bit less straightforward. So let's talk through some of its boundaries here. We can see that posterior to the maxilla is the first boundary. Then superiorly, the greater wing of the sphenoid bone. And posteriorly, we see that styloid process, the mastoid process, and the tympanic plate of the temporal bone. So within this space, below the temporal bone, is the infratemporal fossa. Now, in terms of medial to lateral, it is bounded laterally by the ramus of the mandible, seen here, and medially by that lateral pterygoid plate. So it's within this space here. The inferiormost boundary will be at the point where the medial pterygoid attaches to the angle of the mandible. So right around here. So you can imagine that it will fill in all of that space. I like to think about it in terms of sort of a cup shape, although it is quite an irregularly shaped structure. So don't let this get too, it's not exactly like this, but hopefully the schematic will help you. So we'll note that the temporalis muscle sitting up within here will attach down here onto the coronoid process, and so it will also traverse into the infratemporal fossa as well as the temporal fossa. The other thing that we see in infratemporal fossa will be those pterygoid muscles. Around the pterygoid muscles, we find the maxillary artery and its many branches, as well as the pterygoid venous plexus. And then what we've been looking at earlier is all of that to do with B3. So we see B3 and its branches, the otic ganglion found medially to V3, and the chorda tympani joining the lingual nerve in that infratemporal fossa within this space heading toward the oral cavity. This one is a little harder to do on the skull, but hopefully as we move around some of these lines, these purple lines will make a little bit more sense. But we can see here is sort of that superior boundary is where the end of the temporal fossa is. Laterally, we see the ramus of the mandible as well as the angle of the mandible inferiorly, and then that lateral pterygoid plate medially. Superiorly, we also are looking below that sphenoid bone, but also below the temporal bone. And here you see the parts of the temporal bone that are more of the posterior aspect of it. So the infratemporal fossa sits in this space, and it actually has quite a few communications with other spaces. The first of which makes sense to us, as we had just seen it, is that temporal fossa. So you can imagine there is a communication between here and here from the temporal fossa into the infratemporal fossa. And that is represented here on my cup, just as the superior roof kind of moving back and forth. So also superiorly, we find the communication between the infratemporal fossa and the middle cranial fossa. So this will be through foramen ovale and foramen spinosum, all of those structures we saw passing in and out of the infratemporal fossa through those foramina. Medially, we can see this sort of tear-shaped structure right about here, and that is the pterygomaxillary fissure. So the pterygomaxillary fissure is the entrance into now this space deep within here, kind of shadowed, is the pterygopalatine fossa. So put a pin in that, we're coming back to it, but for now we know that this is how you can go from the infratemporal fossa into the pterygopalatine fossa. The other communication is with the orbit, and that's through the infraorbital fissure. So we'll remember, you can look at this picture on the bottom left, the superior orbital fissure. And then here we see nicely another sort of tear-shaped structure, an infraorbital fissure. And that is sort of a almost continuous here, you can see with that with the pterygomaxillary fissure. So here is pterygomaxillary, and here is infraorbital. So that will then communicate with the orbit. So here we can see in black is shown that space where the temporal fossa communicates with the infratemporal fossa. Next in blue, we're going to see the foramina where the infratemporal fossa communicates with the middle cranial fossa. So here we have the foramen ovale and foramen spinosum. Now, as we move medially, where that green kind of teardrop shape is that pterygomaxillary fissure. So sort of between the pterygoid plate, the lateral pterygoid plate, and the posterior maxilla. And then in yellow is the opening of the infraorbital fissure leading into the orbit. So there is a nice view of it. Great, so in order to kind of review what we've gone through based on what you see in the infratemporal fossa, but also what we've seen previously, in other of these mini lectures, I want you to try to write out or maybe diagram which structures enter or exit the infratemporal fossa through the pterygomaxillary fissure and the foraminal valley. So pause the video so you can take a second to write these things down, and then we'll talk about it. When you're ready, let's start with foraminal valley. So foraminal valley is in that roof, and we definitely have structures entering into the infratemporal fossa here. What is our major structure coming through and forward with lots of branches? And that is V3. So foraminal valley is where V3 enters the infratemporal fossa. Now, what about that tear-shaped pterygomaxillary fissure? What structure might then lead into that space? So here, we're talking about the maxillary artery. So through the pterygomaxillary fissure is where the maxillary artery exits the infratemporal fossa to then enter the pterygopalatine fossa. So the third part, remember, of the maxillary artery is the pterygopalatine part, and many of its branches will happen within that space. All right, that is everything for this video. Thank you all for your attention, and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.